हरे कृष्णा। सो वी हैड टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम चैप्टर 14 वर्स नंबर 18 आई बिलीव। जस्ट सेटिंग अप माय ऑडियो हियर, वन सेकेंड। ओके, right. Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes, provision.
All right, so we start from verse number 18. Let's recite the verse. You can repeat after me. Karmanya karma yaha pashyed. अकर्मणि च कर्मयः सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत् कर्मण्यकर्मयः पश्येद् अकर्मणि च कर्मयः
अकर्मणि च कर्मयः
सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
कर्मण्यकर्मयः पश्येद्
कर्मण्यकर्मयः पश्येद्
अकर्मणि च कर्मयः
अकर्मणि च कर्मयः
सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
न्यूनेस वुड लाइक टू रिसाइट
कर्मण्यकर्मयः
पश्येत् अकर्मणि च कर्मयः सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत् कर्मण्यकर्मयः पश्येत् अकर्मणि च कर्मयः सबुद्धिमान् मनुष्येषु
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत्
सयुक्तः कृष्णकर्मकृत् एनीवन एल्स ओके सो लेट्स रिसाइट द सिनोनिम्स कर्मणि
इन एक्शन
अकर्मा
इन एक्शन
यह
वन हु
पश्येत
ऑब्जर्व्स
अकर्मणि
इन एक्शन
च
आल्सो
कर्म
fruitive action
yaha
one who
saha
he
buddhiman
is intelligent manushyeshu in human society saha
he
yuktah
is in the transcendental position
krishna karma krit although engaged in all activities translation and purport by his divine grace ac bhaktivedanta swami shila prabhupad one who sees inaction and action in inaction is intelligent among men and he is in the transcendental position although engaged in all sorts of activities. Purport: a person acting in Krishna consciousness is naturally free from the bonds of karma. His activities are all performed for Krishna. Therefore, he does not enjoy or suffer any of the effects of work. Consequently, he is intelligent in human society, even though he is engaged in all sorts of activities for Krishna. A karma means without reaction to work. The impersonalist ceases fruitive activities out of fear so that the resultant action may not be a stumbling block on the path of self-realization. But the personalist knows rightly his position as the eternal servitor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, he engages himself in the activities of Krishna consciousness. Because everything is done for Krishna, he enjoys only transcendental happiness in the discharge of this service. Those who are engaged in this process are known to be without desire for personal sense gratification. The sense of eternal servitorship to Krishna makes one immune to all sorts of reactionary elements of work. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. I read the translation one more time. One who sees inaction in action and action in inaction is intelligent among men, and he is in the transcendental position, although engaged in all sorts of activities. So this verse is both a tongue twister and a brain twister. You know, action in inaction and inaction in action. You know, first of all, to speak it is very difficult. You know, it basically it twists the tongue. And then it is all the way more difficult to understand what exactly does this mean. One who sees action in inaction and inaction in action, that person is intelligent. So, of course, by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, what is difficult for regular people to understand, it becomes easy for us to understand. So to understand what happened here, so we see that in the third chapter, Arjuna had asked a question to Krishna that what is it that, you know, even though we don't want to do certain things at certain times, but we are as if forced to do it, you know, against our will. And Krishna started speaking about lust. You know, he says it is lust only, O Arjuna, which is born out of the mode of passion and it turns into wrath. And then while talking about lust, he also talks about how to control the lust. And there he transitions to the fourth chapter. So right in the first verse of the fourth chapter, he starts talking about how he had given this knowledge to the sun god. Imam vivasvate yogam proktavanham avya vivasvan mane vipraha manurikshavake bravit. Now, I gave this knowledge to the sun god in the beginning of the creation. Now, this, the purpose of Krishna for speaking that verse was, he wanted to tell Arjuna that the knowledge that I'm giving to you, you know, the overall knowledge and especially the knowledge to control the lust, this knowledge I have given right at the beginning of the creation, you know, and then evam parampara praptam imam rajarishavidya. And this knowledge has been coming down in parampara, you know, in a chain of disciplic succession. But it appears, sa kalena bhata yogo nashtaha parantapa. Due to the force of time, it appears that this knowledge has been lost, you know, due to the force of time. Of course, kalosmi lokakshekrit pravritta. Krishna says, you know, time I am the destroyer of the three worlds. So it is Krishna only who is time. So by the force of time, it has been lost. It means that, you know, it is by Krishna's will that, you know, this knowledge becomes manifest. And by Krishna's will, he can make this knowledge unmanifest also. Of course, you know, it is the sincerity of the seeker. You know, if the seeker is sincere, then Krishna will reveal this knowledge to the seeker. And that's where Krishna also says that, you know, because you are my friend and you are my devotee, that's why I'm giving this knowledge to you. So he tells Arjuna that you are the right candidate to get this knowledge. You are actually, you are qualified to receive this knowledge. So that's how he starts. And right, you know, and he was about to start giving this knowledge. That's where Arjuna, he interrupts. You know, he wants to, he has a very burning question now, because in the second chapter, Krishna had given some hints about his divinity. In the third chapter, he had given some hints about his divinity. So now, although Arjuna knows that Krishna is the Supreme Person, he is none other than Vishnu who has manifested in this world, but Krishna has not himself revealed it to him any time before this. So Arjuna seeks this opportunity. He wants to hear Krishna's glory from Krishna's own mouth. So he stops Krishna. He interrupts him. He says, wait, don't go further. You know, just first tell me, you know, how could you have given this knowledge to the sun god? You know, aparam bhavato janma, param janma vivasvataha. He says, actually, sun god has come before you. Param janma vivasvataha. He's senior to you in age. So katham etat vigyayaniyam, how am I supposed to understand? Tvam adau proktavan iti, that you told, you instructed this knowledge to sun god in the beginning. So right there, Arjuna stops and he wants to hear Krishna's glory. So now this section that comes next, 4.5 to 4.15, that is like a distraction, you know, because Krishna was going in a flow and he wanted to start talking about karma, you know, what is the motivation for action and how does we get, attached in this material world. So he was going in that flow. But because Arjuna interrupted Krishna in between, so it is like a distraction or a digression. And then the focus comes on Krishna. So Krishna starts talking about himself over there. So he starts talking about that, you know, actually, Arjuna, both you and me, we have taken many, many births, but you don't remember your births. I remember everything. I remember your birth and I remember my birth also. That's how he starts. And then he carries on further. So he talks about his spiritual nature. Ajopisan avyay atma bhutanam ishwaropisan prakritim swamadhishthaya sambhavami atma mayaya. He says that actually I come out of my own sweet will, out of my own internal potency. You know, we come to this material world by bound by the external potency of Krishna. We are forced to take birth and we have no control, you know, where we are going to take birth. Are we going to be in the human species of life or an animal species of life? You know, who will be my father? Who will be my mother? It's just, it's imposed on us. We have to accept it, whether we like it or not. But that's not how it works for Krishna. Krishna says that actually I come out of my own will and I come through my own internal potency. You know, so he talks about, and then he talks about the concept of avatar. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srajamyaham paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanathaya sambhavami yuge yuge. I come in every yuga. So Krishna talks about when he comes and why he comes, when and why, both the things he talks about. And then he gives one additional insight. Janma karma chame devyam evam yoveti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti so Arjuna. He says actually one who understands this transcendental nature of my activities and my appearance, he does not take his birth again in this material world. No, he mam eti so Arjuna, he comes back to me. No, so this was the first hint given by Krishna about a world which is different from the material world, a world which is transcendental to the material world. You know, and then he continues with that in the 4.10. He again talks about vita raga bhaye krodha man mayama upashrita. You know, freed from attachment, anger, and fear. You know, people who attain love for me, you know, they become purified and they attain love for me. But then he also talks about those people who do not understand Krishna's janma and karma. So he, in the 4.11, it's a famous verse, but which Prabhupada quotes a lot of time. Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam satheva bhajamyaham mama vartamanu vartante manushyah partha sarvasha. He says actually those who do not understand my janma and karma, to the degree they surrender into me, accordingly I reward them. And then mama vartamanu vartante manushyah partha sarvasha, all the paths are created by me. So in that sense, every living entity is on a path that is created by me. Of course, different path leads to different results. There are certain paths that go towards Krishna, certain paths that lead away from Krishna, that is like the path to hell. So this section, Krishna gives a lot of information about himself. And then he talks about that, how he has created the system of Varna, you know, Chaturvarnyam maya shrishtam guna karma vibhagasah tasya kartaram apimam vidhya kartaram avyayam. So he says, actually, I have created this system of Varna. So we had discussed in detail about, you know, what is the purpose of creating Varna. Actually, you know, but I am not the doer, in a sense that, you know, he is like the architect of this system, but he doesn't determine who will be at what level in that system of Varna. So what determines, you know, what person, which person will become a Brahmana, which person will become a Kshatriya, Shudra and Vaishya, that is basically determined by the karma of the person. But before he starts talking about karma, you know, he first talks about that no karma actually affects Krishna. Namam karmani limpanti name karma phale spriha. You know, he says that no work can bound me. Why? the reason that he gives that why no work can bound Krishna is he says, na me karma phale spriha. I do not aspire for the fruits of action. So what happens is what bounds us in this material world is not the action itself. It is the motivation for the action that bounds, that binds us, you know. So that is the very key part to understand. What is the motivation with which we are doing the work that actually binds us? So, and then Krishna says, iti mam yo abhi janati karma bhir na sabadhyate. One who understands this truth about me, he himself also doesn't get, bound by the karma. So indirectly, he's telling Arjuna that Arjuna, you should also act like this. You know, don't get bound. You know, don't be, don't aspire for any specific fruit. You know, and then while he's talking about karma, so this verse that we are discussing, 4.18, that talks about the intricacies of karma. So he first tells that it is very difficult to understand the intricacies of karma. Karmano hi apya bodhavyam, bodhavyam cha vikarmanaha, akarmanasya bodhavyam gahana karmanogati. So gahana karmanogati. The intricacies of action are very hard to understand. It's very difficult, extremely difficult to understand, you know, how karma will work, you know, what is to be done and what is not to be done. You know, it's very difficult to understand. And in that sequence, so he first talks about karma, akarma, and vikarma. So of course, he doesn't go into the detail. He doesn't give the definition of what is karma, what is akarma, and what is vikarma. Because that is in the Vedic context, you know, Arjuna is a learned man. It is kind of given that he understands that there are three elements of karma, karma, akarma, and vikarma. So he doesn't go into the detail of what karma is, what akarma is, what vikarma is. That is kind of understood in the, from the context of the Bhagavad Gita. But for our understanding, would someone would like to quickly mention what is karma, what is akarma, and what is vikarma? Anyone? Question is, what is karma, what is akarma, and what is vikarma?
Karma is when we do some auspicious, like philanthropic activities, we get karma. Akarma is we do not get any materialistic result for it. And vikarma is when we do some bad activity, we get some result of it.
Sinful activities, yes. So karma is more fruitive action in the sense that it's a positive fruitive action. Akarma is when there is no material result for the activity. Basically, activities performed in the spiritual plane where we won't get any material benefit or material bad or good or bad reaction out of it. And then vikarma is sinful activities. No papa, which will drag us to hell. That is vikarma. So that is for our understanding. And then within that series, then he talks about karmanya karma yaha pashyat akarmani cha karma yaha sabuddhiman manusheshu sa yuktaha krishna karma krit. You know, one who sees action in inaction and inaction in action, you know, he is actually intelligent among the humans. Now, actually, this, the whole context about of the Gita is about this only, because Arjuna was not able to understand what is to be done and what is not to be done. He himself said it to Krishna that, you know, when he surrendered to Krishna in 2.7, he says, Karpanya dosho pahat subhava prachamitvam dharma sammood chetaha. You know, due to miserly weakness, you know, I don't understand what is to be done and what is not to be done. So therefore, I'm asking you, prachamitvam, I'm asking you, dharma sammood chetaha. Please tell me, what should I do? What is my dharma? Because I am bewildered. You know, I don't understand what is my dharma. So now we know that Arjuna had understood that fighting is bad. That was Arjuna's understanding. He had very clearly said that if I fight this war, I'm going to get sinful reactions. Not once, he says this four times in the first chapter itself. Arjuna says it repeatedly. In 1.36, he says that. 1.37, he says that. 1.38, also he says that, you know, that I will get bound. I will get sinful reactions. And again, he says that I'm going to get sinful reactions in 1.44. 1.36, he had said, Papam eva shreyad asman hatvaitan atatainaha. That is 1.36. 1.37, he had said, कुलक्षये कृतं दोषं मित्रद्रोहे च पातकं. पातकं इज सिनफुल रिएक्शंस. एंड देन 38 ही हैड सेड कथम न ज्ञेयम् अस्माभिः पापाद् अस्मान् निवर्तितुम्. यू नो दैट वाज 38. एंड 44th अगेन ही हैड सेड अहो बता महत् पापं कर्तुं व्यवसिता वयम्. दैट वाज 44. So he was convinced in his mind that if I fight this war, I'm going to get sinful reactions. You know, I'm going to go to hell actually after fighting this war. Four times he says this to Krishna. And Krishna says the opposite to Arjuna. You know, he had told to Arjuna that 2.33, if you remember, Krishna had said, Tataha swadharmam kirtim cha hitva papam avapsyasi. He said that if you don't fight this battle, if you shy away from this battle, then you are definitely going to incur sin, you know, because you are giving up on your duty. It is your duty to fight this war. And because you are giving up your duty, you are going to get sinful results. So very clearly, you know, what was Arjuna's understanding was not actually correct, because Krishna says completely opposite of what Arjuna had understood initially. So it's very clear from the context that it is very difficult to understand. The karma, the gahana karmano gati. It's very difficult to understand the intricacies of action and inaction. So now, what does it mean, one who sees action in inaction and inaction in action? So we know that the word karma is used interchangeably. So first of all, in this verse itself, sa yuktaha prishna karma krit. Yuktaha also has multiple meanings. One meaning of yuktaha is engaged, one who is engaged like this, yuktaha. Another word of another meaning of yuktaha is to have union, you know, so union. And that's where Prabhupada uses that as the root. For yuktaha he uses the union as the root. And Prabhupada translates this as is in the transcendental position, because union with Krishna, this will lead to union with Krishna. Therefore, that is like a transcendental position. So one who understands like this, he is actually in union with Krishna in one sense. So now the word karma itself has multiple meanings. So in one sense, karma just simply means that any activity that we do is karma, just action, good, bad, or whatever. It is just action that is karma. Just do your karma. It could be bad or good, or it doesn't matter. So that is one sense of using the word karma. Then in another sense, karma, as we were just discussing, karma, karma and vikarma, karma refers to positive fruitive actions, that gives positive fruitive results. That is karma. And in the third sense, karma, the word karma is used as the whole system of action and reaction. So sometimes we say that, okay, this is my own karma that is coming to me. So actually it is not karma that is coming to me. It is the reaction of the karma that is coming to me. But we use that. It's just that's how the word karma is used. So here, actually, if you have to understand what this karmanya karma yaha pashyet, akarmani cha karma yaha, what does karma and akarma mean here? So actually, we have to understand that one who sees inaction, that means one who understand that, there can be no reaction to action, and one who understands that there can be reaction to not doing action also, if we understand it like this, then it becomes easier for us to understand. So sometimes, we do some work, but in what consciousness we are doing, that will determine whether we will get a reaction for that action or not. For example, it is understood that it is not good to kill someone. We are going to get, forget about bad karma. First of all, what will happen is by law we'll be prosecuted. If we murder someone, if someone murders someone, then that person is punishable by law. And that punishment is not minor punishment. It is a very severe punishment. But at the same time, we see that a soldier, he goes on the border and then he kills the enemy soldiers, left and right. He has a big gun and then, he can just kill. And then he is getting rewarded when he comes back to his own country. He gets rewarded for it. He gets a bravery medal. So because there was a different motivation for that killing. This killing, that murder can be happening because this person may want to rob the other person, or there was some personal vengeful motivation to kill another person, and that is punishable by law. even for that you will get bad reaction, even after you may get punished by the law. Now, similarly, say for example, if someone is attacking me and I kill that person in self-defense, so then in that case, I will not be punished by by the land of law, because to protect ourselves is acceptable by law. I didn't kill someone to harm him. I was trying to protect myself, and in that shuffle, the other person got whatever killed. So that also is not punishable. So what determines whether we will get reaction for that? What kind of reaction we'll get? So the motivation for the action actually determines that. Now, on the other hand, sometimes we don't do any action also, and there could be reaction to it. How do we understand this? Say, for example, now we see this COVID is going around, especially in India. It has become such a big deal now in India. There is that second wave of COVID that has hit so bad. And I've heard that even my own family members, because my mother also got COVID, and she also was telling me that the situation is so bad that people are in the hospitals, there is no space. People are everywhere in the corridor of the hospital. In one private room, there are 7 patients, and they have converted different hotels into hospital kind of rooms. Now, in such a severe situation, so just imagine this. For example, a doctor may think that, oh, this is so overwhelming, I don't want to do anything. I just sit at work, I'll not go to work. So what will happen is, it is the duty of the doctor. And if he's employed at a government hospital, for example, and then he just doesn't go to work, he just absconds, that I don't want to go to work. So what will happen is, because he is an employee of the government, it is his duty to come to the hospital and save patients. But in this such a crucial time, if he is absconding from his duty, then the government will, he is punishable by law. The government will, for giving up on his duty, the government can actually prosecute that doctor. I mean, that the job will be gone for sure, but he may get some more severe punishments also. And similarly, say, for example, if a patient is very serious and the doctor thinks that, oh, if I do anything, if I try to treat this patient, and if this patient dies anyway, then I will get a bad reaction. So let me not actually do anything with this. Let this patient die. I am not going to touch him, so that I will not become part of his, passing away. So even that kind of mentality is not good. It is the duty of the doctor to do his best. He is supposed to do his duty, and whether the patient will be saved or not, that is not in his hands. At least he would have done his part. So if he does his part, and if still the patient is not saved, then there is no reaction for him, neither good nor bad, because the doctor only acted out of his duty. So we have to understand this action in inaction and inaction in action is one who sees that sometimes there could be reaction even while we don't do any action. And, and sometimes there could be no reaction even though we do the action. Now, coming back to the purport written by Srila Prabhupada, so Prabhupada makes it very clear that actually it is a Krishna conscious person is naturally free from the bonds of karma. Why? Because everything that the person is doing, it is to serve the Lord. He has no personal motivation in that. He thinks that, okay, I want to do this work. And why I want to do this work? I want to do this for serving Krishna. Now, Prabhupada also talks about the Mayavadi sannyasis, the impersonalists, renunciates. They think that, by just giving up on all work, we can be free from the system of karma and akarma. So actually, that's not going to help them. So there was a very, I remember that I've read it about Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. He had a debate with a Mayavadi sannyasi. So we know that Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati himself was a renunciate, and he used to sometimes go in our. So now people used to say that, what kind of a renunciate you are? You're using cars and you are dressing up in this. We know that Prabhupada always used to wear saffron, but at times when Bhaktisiddhanta used to go for preaching, he used to wear traditional Indian clothes. So of course the purpose there was to serve Krishna. There was a purpose for it. So, but he was having this debate, with the Mayavadi sannyasi. So Mayavadi sannyasi said, you know, what kind of renunciate you are? You know, you are using cars and all. Look at me, I am a renunciate. I have renounced everything. You know, I don't. So, and Bhaktisiddhanta gave a very nice point. He said, you know, if you are saying that you have renounced it, then you, in other words, you are saying that before renouncing, it was yours. You know, and then because now you have given up your property, that therefore you are renunciate. But we understand that there is nothing which belongs to us in the first place. Everything in this world belongs to Krishna, and therefore it must be used in the service of Krishna. And when we are engaged like this, that is actually true renunciation. Not that we artificially give it up, thinking that now I'm not going to use it, and therefore I'm a renunciate. I will not get any action or reaction out of it. So this was a very, it's very sobering point also. That everything that we have, even sometimes we consider our own property, we think that this is mine and this is for my own enjoyment. But everything is actually an energy of Krishna only. It is due to Krishna's will that, you know, for some time we have that material opulence or we have certain material property. But if we understand that everything that I have is given to me by Krishna, and then we are supposed to use that in service of Krishna. So that way we become renunciate automatically without having to, you know, officially renounce anything at all. So that is called Yukta Vairagya. You know, Yukta Vairagya is that you have everything, but you are using everything in the service of Krishna. So bhakti, so there is a very key difference between Karma Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. In Karma Yoga, what we do is, we offer the results of our work to Krishna. You know, whatever result we get, we offer it to Krishna, or, you know, we basically renounce the result. We don't keep the result for our own self. In Bhakti Yoga, the difference is that the work itself is done for the pleasure of the Lord. You know, Krishna says in the 9th chapter, Yat karoshi yad ashnasi yad juhusi dadasi yad, yat tapashyasi kaunteya tat purush madarpanam. So when you are doing itself, at that time itself, offer your work to Krishna. So what happens is the work is offered to Krishna, and automatically the result also gets offered to Krishna. When the work is offered to Krishna, you know, then naturally we will not get bound to that work, to the reaction of that work. What is that verse that we had discussed in the 4th chapter itself? In the 3rd chapter, Yagyarthart karma netra lokoyam karma bandhani tadartha karma kaunteya mukta sangha samacharat. Work done as a sacrifice for Vishnu has to be performed. Now that sacrifice actually can also be understood as work done as a worship to Vishnu has to be performed. Worship to Vishnu in the sense that, you know, everything that we are doing, we can make that as a worship to Vishnu, to Krishna. Now, this work that I'm doing, you know, even if we are working in the office, we can say, well, this work that I'm doing, because I've been put into this situation by your will, my Lord, I am supposed to do my best. And, you know, I'm offering this work to you. I want to please you by my action. So please accept my work like this. And actually, Krishna also says this in the 18th chapter. Swakarmanatam abhyarchya siddhim vindati manava. Through your work, worship me, and in that way you can attain perfection. Siddhim vindati manava. Every human can attain perfection if he offers his work itself to me. So in that context, Prabhupada is also explaining that a person acting in Krishna consciousness is naturally free from the bonds of karma, because the work itself is offered to Krishna. There is no question that, you know, we will get attached or bound by the results of the karma. You know, so the motivation itself of doing that work is to please Krishna, or service to Krishna itself. So I just take a quick pause and see if there are any questions, comments, or corrections about what I had said. No questions? No comments, no corrections. Okay. Okay, go to the next verse. I'll share my screen. Okay, so this is 4.19. just let's recite this verse once. You can repeat after me. Yasya sarve samarambha.
Yasya sarve samarambha.
Kama sankalpa varjitaha.
Kama sankalpa varjitaha.
Jnanagni dagda karmanam.
Jnanagni dagda karmanam.
Tam ahu panditam buddhaha.
Tam ahu panditam buddha.
Translation: one is understood to be in full knowledge, whose every endeavor is devoid of desire for sense gratification. He is said by sages to be a worker for whom the reactions of work have been burned up by the fire of perfect knowledge. Purport: only a person in full knowledge can understand the activities of a person in Krishna consciousness. Because the person in Krishna consciousness is devoid of all kinds of sense gratificatory propensities, it is to be understood that he has burned up the reactions of his work by perfect knowledge of his constitutional position as the eternal servitor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is actually learned who has attained to such perfection of knowledge. Development of this knowledge of eternal servitorship to the Lord is compared to fire. Such a fire, once kindled, can burn up all kinds of reactions to work. So again, this is a very soothing verse. Yasya sarve samarambhah kama sankalpa varjitah jnanagni dagda karmanam tam ahu panditam buddhah. So jnanagni dagda karmanam. So dagda means burned by the fire of this knowledge. So it's sometimes Krishna uses very striking words. I think in the towards the end of this chapter, Krishna will say, using knowledge as your weapon, stand up and fight Arjuna. That's how Krishna provokes Arjuna to fight. And here he is saying that by the fire of this knowledge, all the actions and reactions of all work will be burned. Dagdha. So this word dagdha, I remember there is this pastime of Arjuna. He had a fight with one of the Gandharvas, Chitraratha. Chitraratha is considered to be the kings of the Gandharva, the king of the Gandharvas. And they had a fight. I'm trying to remember the context in which they fight. This happens when the Pandavas are in the forest. They are in not incognito, but they were in the forest after they lost the gambling match. So I can't remember the context, but there is a fight that happens, and Gandharvas are supposed to be very, very strong. You know, humans are no match for them. You know, one of the Arjuna's ancestors was killed by a Gandharva. Although this ancestor of Arjuna, I'm missing the name, was very, very powerful. He was so powerful that in all the three words, his name was there. And there was a Gandharva of the same name that he had, that the Gandharva couldn't tolerate it. So he came and he challenged this ancestor of Arjuna, and then he was killed by that Gandharva. So Gandharvas, they are supposed to be much more powerful than the human beings. So, and this was, Chitraratha was not an ordinary Gandharva. He was the king of the Gandharvas. So Arjuna and Chitraratha fight, and of course Arjuna defeats Chitraratha. And the fight was so severe. So Chitraratha means one who has a very beautiful chariot. So this Chitraratha was named after his chariot because his chariot was extremely beautiful. But during the fight with Arjuna, Arjuna used such weapons that his chariot got burnt. So, and this Gandharva was, you know, astonished that how could this human defeat me? I'm not just a Gandharva, I'm the king of the Gandharvas. So of course he accepted his defeat with Arjuna. And then he told Arjuna that, Arjuna, I'm so pleased with you that, you know, from now on, I'm going to take up a new name. You know, from today I'll be called not Chitraratha, but Dagdaratha. Dagdaratha means whose chariot has been burnt up. So to honor Arjuna, he accepted that name, Dagdha. Dagdha means burnt. So that same Dagdha word is used here. So it reminded me of that pastime. So now we were talking about that verse from the third chapter. Yagyarthartha karmanonyatra lokoyam karma bandhani tadartha karma kaunteya mukta sangha samacharat. So that actually applies here also, that, you know, what happens is that when we perform work as a sacrifice, so we don't get bound by the results of the action. Now, sometimes we may say, you know, we have heard this, that, okay, we say that, okay, once you become a devotee, then you don't get any reaction. But we see that even the devotees sometimes have to suffer. So how do we understand this? So why do devotees have to suffer if their karma, if they are not getting any reactions for their actions and all their reactions have been burnt up? So why are they getting reactions? So there are multiple understandings that are given. Prabhupada had said once that, you know, once you switch off the fan, once you shut the switch off, the fan, when it is, you know, rotating, it will rotate for a few minutes and then it will take a while to stop for the fan. So what it means is that no new karma is generated, but whatever karma had been generated in the past, you know, you'll get the results for that, those karma. And then actually after that, this fan will stop, or, you know, so we'll stop getting the reactions of our work. So I know we probably would have discussed this when we were discussing 4.17, but this, the whole system of karma can be understood by three concepts. So we have three different words that we use sometimes. So we use the word Sanchit karma, then we use the word Prarabdha karma, and then there is another word that we used, Agami karma. So Sanchit karma is basically all the reactions, the results of our work that we have accumulated so far, whatever work we have done, it could be good or it could be bad. So Sanchit karma is that this is all the accumulated karma that we have in our balance and that we have to spend, you know, spend in the sense that when we get good results or bad results, either way, we have to spend this Sanchit karma. So consider a water tank, you know, suppose there is a big water tank and there is water inside the tank and there is a tap on the top of the water tank from which the water is coming inside the tank. And then there is a tap at the bottom of the tank from which the water is going out. So now in this analogy, it's an analogy. So of course, every analogy has some limitations. So consider that the water which is inside the water tank, that is our Sanchit karma. Sanchit karma in a sense, that is the accumulated karma that we have to spend. The top with the tap, which is at the top of the water tank, that is like the water that is coming from that tap inside the water tank. That is like the Agami karma. That is the new karma that we are generating. You know, that is whatever we are doing now, we are generating some karma. So that is like the water coming inside, more karma coming into our bank balance, our balance of karma. And then the water, the tap from which the water is going out, that is like the Agami karma. Agami karma, that means that the reactions that we are getting now, you know, whatever is happening in our life, sometimes good things happen, sometimes bad things happen. So that is because of our Agami karma. So this karma is coming to us now. Now, what happens in the case of a devotee is that the tap on the top of the water tank, that gets shut off. Because all the actions that we are doing, that is performed in Krishna consciousness, you know, there is no new karma that we are generating. You know, everything is done as a service for Krishna. So there is no material reaction to that. So consider that water has been shut off now, but still there is some Sanchit karma. You know, that water is still there in the tank, and it will take some time for that water to go out from the tap, which is open at the bottom. So the Agami karma is still coming to us. So at some point, the water which is accumulated in the water tank, it is going to get over. You know, so our Sanchit karma will get over, but we are not going to generate any new karma. So when the Sanchit karma is going to get over, that time we'll get liberated. So that's how this concept is understood. So for devotees, now, so Gahana Karmano Gati. So we have to understand this, that, you know, sometimes we say that, you know, for every action, there is equal and opposite reaction. That's the third law of Newton. But in the case of karma, there is definitely a reaction to every action, but it may or may not be equal. You know, it may, you know, sometimes we can get more reaction, sometimes versus killing a cow. You know, there is a lot of, the action is the same, it is killing. But in the case of a deer, the reaction may be different. And in the case of killing a cow, the reaction must be the reaction may be much more severe. Similarly, killing a Shudra versus killing a Brahman, the action is the same, but you know, the reaction would be very, very different in both the cases. So for every action, there is a reaction, but it may not be equal. So now the Gahana Karmano Gati applies to Karmis, but in the case of devotees, this Gahana is all the more Gahana. It is all the more complicated. It's not so easy to understand how this Karma and Akarma and Vikarma works in the case of devotees. So how it is explained by the Acharyas is that Krishna himself takes charge of the Sanchit Karma, which is, of course, there is no new karma that is being generated, but the karma that is accumulated. So Krishna himself takes charge of that. Now we may say that why would Krishna give any reaction to us at all? You know, why can't just Krishna burn it up? Krishna is omnipotent. You know, he's omniscient. He can do everything that he wants to do. Of course, he can do that. He can burn up all the karma, and you know, he can make sure that, you know, our life will be very hunky-dory and there is no, at least if not good, no bad things are happening in our life. But what happens is sometimes devotees, you know, if everything is going hunky-dory in the life, then the devotees also become, a laid back. The devotees may go in the comfort zone. Everything is going good. What is the need for me to do anything at all? You know, just relax. You know, I don't have to. So what happens is we sometimes forget that this place is a place of misery. So it is like a poke from Krishna so that we don't forget that this place is a place of misery. So he keeps reminding us that we don't have to become relaxed. We don't have to go in a comfort zone. We don't have to, go in a zone where, you know, we may fall down again. So that's how sometimes Acharya explained that Krishna may give bad results at times to the devotees. Of course, it is explained by the Acharyas that Krishna, the reaction becomes very, very mild. Now, for example, if for a particular action, a person was supposed to have his leg amputated or hand amputated, then he will just be let go in just a minor cut on his hand or on his leg. You know, so the severity becomes very, very less in the case of devotees. So that's how Prabhupada also explains this, that we have to understand that, you know, anything that bad that is happening in our life, so we have to understand that, you know, we were supposed to get much more worse reaction, but it is the mercy of Krishna that he actually minimized the reaction for us. And similarly, when something good happens in our life, we have to understand, take it as a mercy of Krishna, that this is Krishna who is doing in our life, and we have to thank Krishna in that way. So that should be our consciousness when good or bad things happen in our life. So everything is a mercy of Krishna. That's how we have to understand. Something good happens in our life, something bad happens in our life. That is also mercy of Krishna. Mercy in a sense that we may not be able to understand that, oh, this bad thing is happening because of mercy of Krishna. We have to understand that, okay, you know, we were supposed to get much more worse reaction, but it is a mercy of Krishna that, you know, he minimized the severity of it for me. So I'll take a quick stop here and see if there are any questions or comments or correction about what I said.
But how can we understand that the severity is less than the Govind?
Yeah, that's what Mataji.
It's pretty bad that, like, this is called severity is less.
Yeah.
I mean, of course, it could be much more horrendous than anything we can experience, you know.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, there are so many ways in which people are suffering in this world, Mataji. So.
Yeah, I know. I know. Yesterday, though, something happened to me that I thought Krishna gave me less than what I deserve. I locked myself out of the car at the grocery store, you know.
Oh. Yeah.
My husband was at the beach. My neighbor, who always helped me out, was in New Hampshire. I was trying to call Sudevi Priya. She was not picking up at home. No, but I had even left my cell phone in the car. I'd just taken my wallet. So these days you don't even know numbers on the top of your head unless you have your cell phone. So I'm like all frantic. What am I going to do? You know, and all these groceries sitting in the cart, you know, in the hot day, you know, I don't know what to do. Then I just went over to one of the park guys in the parking lot. I said, do you live close by? And he said, yes. And I said, can you give me a ride home? You know, so he said, sure, I'm doing nothing this afternoon. you know, people nice. Aren't very nice in Simsbury, and you know. So I said, yeah, I was, felt very grateful that he was giving me a ride. So here I'm thinking like, okay, my problem is solved to some degree. The guy was even ready to bring me back, you know.
Oh, okay.
But then I said, no, I don't want you to bring me back. I have to hunt for the spare key. I don't want to wait, you know, outside while I'm hunting for my spare key, you know. So he dropped me in Simsbury. I said, I'll just ask my neighbor's house and see if somebody's home and take me there. So I come, I bring the groceries in, and I'm looking in his car for the, I had bought like two cards, you know, birthday card and a get well card for a coworker of mine. And then I'd bought a $50 Amazon gift certificate. That bag was missing. So I'm thinking like one thing after another is going bad, right? Then I said, oh my God, I left it in the cart, you know, so this guy gave me a ride and I thought everything was solved. No. The day was getting even worse by the minute. You know? So then I got the spare key, went to one of my neighbor's house. She was home. She gave me a ride back and I was all frantic. And then, of course, I opened my car and then I went inside the grocery store, just said, let me just check just in case somebody gave it in. And lo and behold, the town being Simsbury, you know? Everybody is very honest here, you know. This is the second time I found something inside the grocery store. Somebody had turned it in and I got my $60 worth back. back. So I said, oh my God, even if I was having such a bad day, Krishna was saving me.
Yeah, he saved the day for you.
Now I know why your husband wanted to move to Simsbury.
This is the second time. Remember, like about 25 years ago, I lost my wallet. My wallet fell in the parking lot, and I was like hunting for it all day. And my husband was screaming at me with all the credit cards and so many things in the wallet, you know. And then at the end of the day, I said, let me go to the grocery store and check, because I had gone to the grocery store. And lo and behold, somebody had turned the wallet in Simsbury, same store. So that's the second time I found something inside the store that somebody had actually turned in, even though I left it in the parking lot. Only in Simsbury this happens.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Prabhuji, please.
Krishna comes to give this knowledge, you said, and he can take it away. And what does that mean by he can take it away? Of course, he can do anything, so... What do you mean by he can take it away?
Take it away in the sense that he may make it unmanifest, because there could be people who are not qualified to get this knowledge, right? Because Krishna establishes the qualification that who is supposed to get this knowledge, who is supposed to have this knowledge. Bhaktosi me sakha cheti rahasyam hi etad uttamam. So he says, because you are my devotee and you are a dear friend, that's why I'm giving this knowledge to you. This knowledge appears to have been lost, but I'm giving this knowledge to you because you are my devotee and my friend. And Prabhupada also quotes this point in the introduction of the Bhagavad Gita itself, that, you know, this, he puts a lot of stress on this. He quotes this verse, Bhaktosi me sakha cheti, that this is the qualification to receive the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita.
So there's a time when there's nobody at all has any
qualified to get, right? Or there could be people who are qualified to get to have that knowledge, but they keep it to themselves. So for example, if you may want to give this knowledge to someone, but if he is not qualified to get this knowledge, even if you try to give that knowledge to that person, he will not be able to understand that knowledge. So both could be possible. So we are in Kali Yuga, and we know that Kali Yuga is a time of spectacular spiritual ignorance. Yet there are devotees who have this knowledge. And when they try to give this knowledge to others, even though we do our best effort, but people are not able to understand this knowledge because they are not qualified enough to get this knowledge yet.
But Srila Prabhupada did say, I am your qualification, when he, you know, is because no one was really qualified to receive the knowledge that he was trying to give, but they still changed spectacularly.
Yeah.
In spite of your saying this is a spectacularly spiritual stage, that's because he was their qualification. Yeah.
Very true, Mataji. mercy of Prabhupada.
Mercy, yeah.
He said he created our good fortune.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems like I don't see where he takes it away. It's up to us, because it's the most secret of all secrets. You're going to have to be qualified to understand it.
Actually, the reason I said it is by the will of Krishna that this knowledge may get lost. So he says, Sa kalenaha mahata yogo nashtaha parantapa. Due to the force of time, this knowledge appears to have been lost. And yet Krishna also says later in the 10th chapter.
Appears to have been.
Right.
So it appears like it's lost, but it's not lost.
It's not lost. Yeah, that's true. But Acharya has explained that Krishna says in the 11th chapter, Kalosmi lokakshay krit pravriddha. No, time I am. No, I am the time. Right. And here he's saying that it is due to the time that this knowledge appears to have been lost. So what it means is it is the will of Krishna. And ultimately, everything happens by the will of Krishna. Not a blade of grass moves without the will of the Lord. So that way, the Acharya also explained this, that, you know, the time is non-different from Krishna. It is Krishna only whose time. So it is by the will of the Lord that the knowledge may have been lost or appears to have been lost. That's what I was trying to explain, Prabhuji.
Yeah. But it doesn't seem like Krishna, by his will, I don't want this knowledge to be there anymore. It's because there's nobody that's interested in it. So why should I give it to you, you know? Why should I waste it on you? But there are some people, so it appears that it's lost. Knowledge is always there.
Always there.
And even if you... Even in your heart, he can give you this knowledge. If you're sincere.
That is
the way you said it. It sounded like he takes it away. He's given it to us now, then he takes away this knowledge because he feels like it. It's because we don't want it. Man proposes, God disposes. If we want something, he gives it. If we don't want it, we don't, you know, even the ability. Your hand, or your arm, if you don't use your arm, you lose the ability to use your arm. Your arm gets thinner. It just, I saw, this was in a National Enquirer when I was probably 60 years ago or something like that, 55 years ago. But it had this guy with these big, huge fingernails. You can't see me, but they're big, you know, like 10 inches fingernails or 12 inches, really long, curling on one hand. And he doesn't use that arm because he doesn't want to break his nails, and he's losing, his arm is becoming very, very weak. So if we don't utilize something, it gets taken away. But it's not that he wills, like I'm going to will it at this certain time, I'm taking it away. It's up to us. If we want it, he'll come and give it again to somebody qualified. And because Krishna has given the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, it's not for Arjuna that he's given the Bhagavad Gita. He first put Arjuna in illusion in order to speak Bhagavad Gita for those people in Kali Yuga. So he's given us an easy way to, may not seem so easy for Kali Yuga, but it's a very easy way to get back home, back to Godhead.
So, can I ask you a question? You said, in what context did Srila Prabhupada say, I'm your good fortune?
Yeah, it's like, what have I done? What have I done to deserve this? And Prabhupada says, I have created your good fortune. You didn't
Who said, what have I done to deserve this?
A devotee of Srila Prabhupada. Wasn't me. I never talked to Srila Prabhupada.
No, but Srila Prabhupada also said that in another context, now I remember, where the sun never shines, by Ranchor Das in England. You know, they were, I don't know if it was him or somebody else, was walking in a park, and he saw this bum sleeping on a bench. And the devotee asks, what about this person? He has no good fortune. You know, he's you know, so poor and so destitute. And Srila Prabhupada lifted his cane and he pointed to him and he said, you are his good fortune. I guess he meant you need to preach, you know, and create good fortune for others. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So that same sentence he used in a different context, that you need to be somebody else's good fortune now.
Anyway, I'd like to say I heard about 2/3 of the class, and I had to go outside and do some things. But I thought what I did here was very good, except this one thing, because I try to find some fault in everything.
No, thank you so much for correcting me, Prabhuji. I was thinking about when you said that Krishna can give the knowledge in our heart also. You know, he can do that. That's very true. There is a pastime. I was trying to remember the name of the person. I'm missing that name. In the 11th canto, there is this prostitute who gets, what is the name, Mataji, you said?
Pingala.
Pingala, yes, Mataji, thank you. So Pingala gets that kind of renunciation, just without any external, source. Just internally, she suddenly one day she gets that renunciation, and then she becomes like a devotee.
Like a devotee or a devotee?
Devotee, yeah. That comes in the Uddhav Gita section where Krishna himself is talking about Pingala. That's so amazing. Krishna is telling to Uddhava about Pingala. So definitely she must be a devotee. Otherwise, Krishna wouldn't talk about it.
I don't think he takes too much interest in just ordinary prostitutes.
Exactly, yeah. Okay. Any other points anyone would like to add? Okay, all right, then we can stop here. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining. Vancha kalpatarubhyascha kripasindhyabhyo patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namah. Ananta koti vaishnavebhyo Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Jai Krishna.
Anupati Gaurav Prabhu ki jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki
jai. I'm not doing the verse tomorrow anyway. So
yeah,
I don't need to know.
That's right.